Greetings. While discussing Surah 425 with a Muslim, he gave the most amazing excuses. But you have to see them to really believe a Muslim would make this kind of outlandish claim. I wrote the following initially. 425 is pretty long and rambling, and it is available to look up online should one be interested. He wanted me to read 425 and add it to my video. Reading through it, however, it is fascinating that it states you can marry a believing slave girl you own, which means it's okay to own, outright own as slaves, Muslim women. Fascinating. Beyond that, you must pay for them to, some translations say, their people, owners, masters, whoever that may be that remains after they are conquered and enslaved. Seems contradictory. Believing, he typed in bold print. Thank you. It could be a Muslim or non-Muslim. How come a Muslim? She converted and chose to remain a maid living at her master's house. And I had covered in the video the claim of voluntary conversion because of how nice Islam was. So I answered, wrong. Only Muslims are believers. Christians are pagans and infidels, according to the clear Quran. We exceed our religion and are pagan polytheists because we understand, recognize, submit to, and worship the Son of God. We are not believers, my friend, according to Islam, and it is dishonest of you to claim otherwise. If I am a believer, then my salvation is assured, and I have no reason to ever consider changing to Muhammad's religion. If you claim I must change, you prove I am not a believer. I think you need to remember that argument whenever a Mohammedan tries to claim believer means more than pure Muslim. Islam is not related to the Gospel of Jesus, nor the Torah, nor the Bible. But the subterfuge and deception of Islam wants you to lower your guard and abandon the truth. Then maybe you begin to fall for the lies of Islam. Look more closely at 425, my friend. It contradicts who owns the slave girl. It begins, marry your believing slave girls that you own, and then says to pay their masters or their owners. Some translations say families or folk or their people. The fact that some or many say owner or master means the clear Quran is not clear on the subject, my friend. But I've already covered why the family claim makes no sense in the prior video. He wrote, different meanings and translations cover different situations, my friend. That's being generic. And I see it as a proof that Quran is applicable for any place and time. But to you is unclear because it should deal with one specific situation in your head, which is not the case. Now this was the statement that made my jaw drop open. Think about what this first statement implies. Different meanings and translations cover different situations, my friend. Can you see the pick and choose nature of Mohammedism? You may pick and choose the translation you feel fits your situation. You may pick and choose the meaning you want for your situation. Different meanings and translations cover different situations, my friend. Those are two different things. Think about just how this flies in the face of there is only one Quran, the Arabic. And as I thought about this answer, it just never occurred to me to create my own truth that way. When I study, whether the Bible or the Quran, I read many translations. I am looking for the real meaning. For the Bible, the one that God intended. I believe that is first found in the common meaning, the average meaning, or the logical meaning. I look to see the one translation which reads nothing like the majority of the others, and I kind of dismiss that rogue translation. I don't create new dogma based on one fringe twisting, but it looks to me that this follower of Islam looks to rationalize his idea with whatever translation he can make fit. He wrote, "That's being generic, and I see it as a proof that Quran is applicable for any place and time. Christians, I really want you to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit inside you. I believe you should have red flags and fire alarms going off inside when you read this. Do you really think God's message is generic, so any meaning it can be twisted into can be applied for any place and time? Or would you perhaps explain it differently? God's word is universal truth. His teachings are always true and can always be applied. But we do not selectively change the meanings to fit or suit our current situation. In these last days, I believe the truth is our lifeline. The gross deception and schemes in the world today make me shake my head and mourn. The Mohammedan's answer is nothing but situational religion. But this is not the message of Jesus, nor the message of the prophets of the one true living God. I answered him with this. Bless your heart, brother. You are stating that the Quran means nothing in particular and can mean anything anytime you have a different situation. You or any follower just make up what you want it to say and mean. That's not being generic. It is being unclear and being unreliable. But it also means that you accept my very damning interpretation because you have no basis upon which to disagree with it. You cannot say what it means, therefore you cannot refute the clear text. Remember, this is in the context of Surah 425, which accepts slavery of Muslim women and temporary marriage, and contradicts itself about who the owner of the female slave is. But I wanted to address that point for a moment. One of my biggest peeves about Muhammad's insane ramblings is his psychotic channeling. He changes voice from himself to Allah to Jibreel to someone or something else, sometimes from word to word within an ayat. And within this ayat, if I was a Mohammedan, I would try and claim the following. Muhammad begins speaking to you, the single men in general in his army, and then as Mo is wont to do, he changes pronouns without notice. So when Muhammad begins, he says the Muslim women you own, meaning he's sweeping and talking of all the men who own slaves. Then Muhammad flips his switch and talks of their owners, imagining the individual soldiers who own particular slave girls. It is completely unsatisfying to me, and I think it's intellectually bankrupt, to have to jump through such flaming hoops to claim the Quran makes sense. But I can anticipate that the poor souls deceived in Islam would gladly accept such flaccid rationalization. So what else did this Mohammedan say worth reviewing? The terminology of it being so powerful that one word can have different translations to cover all the aspects of it is a sign of its miraculousness. I really could not make this stuff up and keep a straight face. However, it's most comfortable and easiest for ignorant people who don't understand it, because they're simply illiterate, to claim that it's not clear. And now he's confusing illiterate with ignorant, but the two are different. And hoping to intimidate me with his insult, that I call it unclear because I am ignorant and illiterate. Read it again and dissect the insult hurled as a defensive maneuver. However, it's most comfortable and easiest for ignorant people, and then a parenthetical thought, to claim that it's not clear. Can you see the nature of the insult? The claim the Quran is not clear arises from ignorance and comfort and ease, not serious study and critique. For ignorant people who don't understand it because they're simply illiterate. Unfortunately, illiterate means unable to read, not unable to comprehend. And this tragically demonstrates the approach of Islam to all intellectual challenge. If you read the Quran and you see fault in the Quran, you are illiterate. This is why simply talking to Mohammedans is so hard. It is like talking to evolutionists or global warmers. If temperature rises, it is global warming, and it is man's fault, or more precisely, America's fault. If temperature falls, it is global warming, and it is man's fault, or more precisely, America's fault. And if you honestly examine the conclusion the theory always arrives at, we can see, no matter what happens, it is America's fault. This is how you can know current global warming dogma is nothing but politically driven nonsense. But I digress. Ask your teachers about the differences between Arabic and English. They might be able to help. I honestly believe, or suspect strongly, that Satan's selection of Arabic was part of his scheme as the best of deceivers. The Quran can say nothing in Arabic, yet be twisted into anything. That's pretty much exactly how I read and understand his rationales and excuses for this surah. You will have to decide whether you fall for such flaccid excuses or whether you want clear truth. You will have to decide if you trust your own ability to read and comprehend, or if you can be kowtowed by being called illiterate. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.